She'll be an interesting one to be the fly on the wall because he seems to have been snubbed by the West Indies selectors. But anyway, Smith was caught Rhys Bolt-Waters for naught. Boyce caught Rhys Bolt-Waters for naught. And Dutoit, LBW Bolt-Waters for naught. So that was an extremely bad start. They were indeed, what were they, three... Goodness me, yep, they were 3-for-1 at one stage. 3-for-3. And 29-for-4 also. But LBW Bold Allenby was Cobb for 26. And Sarwine's on 13. And Eckersley is on 14. They're 55-for-4. So that'll be interesting to see.
It's interesting, isn't it? I mean, normal service has been resumed in terms of April weather, and inevitably, the ball is doing an awful lot more damage than the bat. And one thinks of how England have come back so well in Sri Lanka in their own backyard, but it must be said that had Sri Lanka been playing England in conditions such as those that now prevail in England at this precise point, one imagines they'd have been sent packing, really. So those scores are interesting because they've...
Yeah, I mean, this is a little bugbear of mine. I always feel that... I know it was always the case years ago, but I always think it's a bit of a shame when a kind of hollow victory feeling when teams dominate series at home and then they travel and they don't travel well, and you sort of feel, well, you want to see wherever cricketers are playing, you know, a clear kind of merit of performance based on actual performance rather than just being used to your own conditions and etc. And it can become a little bit predictable at times. However, I've contradicted myself there because at the end of the day, we're getting an awful lot of unpredictable finishes, particularly in Test cricket, and a lot of matches ending within 3 days, which is a bit of a concern, as well as it being often highly entertaining. It is a bit of a worry. Nottinghamshire, incidentally, I think it's Nottinghamshire, 37 for 5 now, actually. Nottinghamshire. Hales was caught Solanke Bold Richardson for 4. Lum caught Scott Bold Lucas for 3. Taylor, I think that's James Taylor, caught, of course, Ion England, caught Kersa V Bold Jones for 4. Vessels, don't know if he's any relations to Kepler Vessels. Caught Klinger Bold Jones for 0. Chris Reed caught Mitchell Bold Jones for 4. Frank's not out 0. And Edwards not out 14, so they're 37 for 5.
You see, interestingly, Ben, it means what you're saying effectively is, in terms of the county championship, no one, or unless I'm mistaken, I may be, but no one appears as yet to be averaging 40 for the first class season, which means that James Hildreth's 268 the other day, I can't recall if he was out or not out, of course, that makes a big difference, but he's 268 the other day, places him high and dry at the top of the first class averages. And let's not forget, it was only a few years ago, albeit at a higher level against the county in a county championship match against Warwickshire, I think it was 3 years ago, he made 303 in his first class knock of the summer. So at one point his first class average for the year was 303.
Got a very interesting statistic here, just after you finished from Surrey's game.
Yeah, he is someone who, when he gets in, he's difficult to dislodge, and he's a man who likes to score big. No question about that. I hope he gets the opportunity to do so today, Ben. I really do.
Well, it's interesting, at Surrey, just to update you with Surrey's situation happening in the Oval, lovely ground there in London. Chris Jordan opened the batting for Surrey. I find that most unusual. Again, I slightly on the West Indies. I know that he wants to play... was thinking of playing for England, so I don't really know what situation is with that. I'm sure he's from Barbados, but hasn't come into the play for the West Indies as yet. But interesting bowler. Saw him bowl Monday week last here in Taunton. Bowled a beautiful Yorker to get Peter Trigo out for 99, I remember. A very memorable finish for me in that commentary stint. But Jacques Rudolph, the South African opener, caught Joyce bowled Naveed Arif for naught. Chris Jordan, as I say, strangely, usually a low-order batsman. He's sort of an all-rounder, mainly a bowling all-rounder, I thought. So opening the batting is quite an unusual one there. I wonder why that happened. But anyway, he was bowled by Khan for 7. Ram Prakash is not out 20. And Debrain, Ion Somerset, remembering Xander Debrain there, who's played for quite a long time. He's not out 29, and they're 71 for 2. Rory Hamilton-Brown, of course, due in next, again with an eye on England regarding that piece in the paper that you were talking to me about earlier. I think we're just coming up to our last score now from the county championship. We've got, 90 for no wicket. Kenta bucking the trend there versus Yorkshire at Leeds. Robert Key, the seasoned veteran, is 37.
Good old Robert Key.
Yes, indeed. Should have played more for England. Scott Newman is on 47 after 21.4 overs. Kent won the toss and elected to bat. So good old-fashioned county championship cricket there. They elected to bat and then 90 for none. You'd think it was a lovely hot sunny day or something from that scorecard, completely at odds with every other scorecard in the country, where it seems to be carnage in terms of wickets going down. So that is the update on the situation with the county championship. So it really has been a pleasure once more speaking to our listeners. I hope we've managed to entertain you with our talk of various cricketing games and statistics and the international and national situation.
Thoroughly enjoyable 1.5 hours. Sorry we've not been able to provide you with live entertainment to the cricket variety, but I hope that our entertaining dialogue, discussion and so on has to some extent filled the breach. But it is 12:30, it's the official time for lunch here on the first day of the LV County Championship match between Somerset and Somerset. No favour for lunch, it's not raining, the sky is clearing, there's always hope, the best is yet to be, and hope please join us. It's fun for the start of the afternoon session of the first day's play on what could be a season of magic.
Well, indeed. Look, a pleasure to speak to you all once again. Goodbye from me, Ben Manning, and from my colleague, the team, Julian Cattanach. And we'll hopefully see you all soon, hopefully with some cricket.
And from my colleague, the team, Julian Cattanach. We'll hopefully see you all soon, hopefully with some cricket.
There's been periods when of course, poor James Anderson has quite understandably been extremely frustrated. But you know, this is the game, this wonderful game that we have. I mean, if every match was predictable, how boring that would be. You know, people who don't know anything about cricket really don't realise that. Probably out of all the sports, and whether you can call cricket a sport, it's more than that to its lovers, but it delights, it seems, in coming up with the unexpected. And sometimes it might sound a bit crazy to say this, but there's nothing worse than a one-sided victory, even if you're the team that wins. I'm one of those people that I love to see a contest. You know, if England do win, I like to see something that's hard fought, something competitive. I think that's what we all want to see, and that's where it can be so disappointing when you see a West Indies team turning up in freezing conditions in May, probably all their best players at the IPL or whatever, and you know, when the heart really isn't in it, when as I say, years gone by, probably the greatest team ever known. So I think I just think it's about obviously that the IPL has a bit of an impact on teams and their strengths, but I think we all just want to see something competitive, and if England win, then that's a bonus. That's how I feel about it.
It'd be lovely to see them do so. It's of course in the recent years, in the last year or two, no more, since the introduction of the DRS, that has, should we say, precipitated premature ends to test matches. I think a lot of people are concerned that the benefit of the doubt, which has always traditionally favoured batsmen, no longer does so now, and one still finds oneself cringing when the ball hits a leg bail by a quarter of a millimetre and it's given out. The worrying characteristic of the DRS, I think, is that it's likely to ensure test matches end 2 or 3 days early in many respects. And I think one day cricket is to blame for the fact that cricketers don't have the mental discipline, the aptitude to bat for lengthy periods as a result of 2020 and so on. But also, it means that batsmen are going to score far fewer hundreds.
Batting
averages will go down. Team scores will diminish, team scores in general. But I think my suspicion with regard to the DRS is that insofar as test matches start ending 2 or 3 days early, it'll upset all the chaps in suits. In order to make more money, they'll want to try and ensure the game goes on for as long as possible. So maybe if we're lucky for once, the issue of money making will cause the DRS to be shelved. Now, interestingly enough,
I know what you're saying.
I hope this isn't important of things to come. We've had such a profound fall of precipitation here at this lovely town.
You like that word, don't you?
Two ducks waddling from left to right. Two ducks moving with some alacrity, it must be said, towards the commentary box. Whether that's symptomatic of, well, let's hope Middlesex bat first, in which case Dexter and Crook will be out for not many, rather than Trescothick and Sapire. But they're both waddling
very purposeful,
Now, that's interesting, Ben. If I may just raise this point with you, looking at the Somerset side here, the side we have before us, and we're probably all going to be made to look fools when they change the side again, and we haven't been made aware of it. But on the assumption that Trescothick, Sapire, Compton, Hildreth, Keith, Vassar, Trigo, Butler, Mesty, Philander, Dockrell and Kirby are the starting lineup. One of those chaps who's a lovely player and played a lovely innings at the end of last year, one of the championship matches towards the end of the season, someone who's a bit of a question mark over him is Al Sapire. I mean, do you see him as, now he's established after so much hard work his full-time English-British residency, and given how hard I've seen him work, is he, as it were, in for a penny, in for a pound, or is he still, you know, not quite secure in his first team place, in first-class cricket?
It's difficult because I know that, you know, we've got one of the best performance academies, most strongest in terms of counties in the country. So there's a hell of a lot of youngsters knocking on the door. But then at the same time, you know, players sort of travel around such a lot now. I'm hoping he's here to stay. I think he's a good cricketer. I think what you want is solidity at the top. I can't see really any problem with him at the moment. I would stick with him. I think he's used to batting with Trescothick. I think they've got a good you know, partnership there. And I wouldn't hesitate to say change a winning formula, but we've done pretty well in recent seasons, so I think I can get away with saying that. I would stick with him. I think he's quite a mature cricketer. I know he's had bad patches, but that happens to most batsmen in their careers. I mean, you don't have a playfair on you, but his career statistics are quite
I believe he's averaging about 34 in his first class career. He made a splendid 150 a year or two ago, which I thought was a beautiful innings. He is a touch cricketer.
Yes.
He's also a delightful fellow. Works unbelievably hard.
Yes,
and of course, I know I may have shared this story on air before, but last year, poor chap had a frightful head cold and more, kind of flu-y sort of symptoms, really. And I was in the doctor's surgery around the corner here, and there was poor Arrow looking dreadful, poor fellow, with this dreadful flu virus.
Right.
I had to acquire some medication. And anyway, 2 days later, I don't know if the medication achieved anything, but he went off and took 6-for-1 in a 20-over game. It was,
goodness me.
To this day, I think it was 6-for-1 or 6-for, Somerset 6-for-1, was it?
Wow, goodness,
and
yes.
I understand they are the current all-time record for 2020 bowler. So, but he's also a fine spinner, and he's not the world's worst fielder. He's very much an Ian Blackwell when it comes to spin bowling. I know he bowls extraordinarily slowly, which I think is a huge advantage. And I think, and this is certainly true, I think, when you look at the subcontinental pitches, and one wonders whether in 20 over cricket, whether in one day cricket generally, whether you'd be better off packing your side with spinners so the chap can't hit the ball off the square.
Well, yes, I mean, this is interesting because, again, you know, people, you know, hate to sound like a cynic about it, because, I mean, Simon Hughes wrote, I think, the other day on Crick Info, what is there not to like about the IPL? Well, I think that the only problem with the IPL is, as you say, I think that a lot of teams now are frightened to pick fast bowlers because they feel that all that pace on the ball, just a slightly out of length, you know, bad length or whatever, and it's just going to get, you know, nicked for six kind of thing with the away from bowlers. I mean, we grew up in an era which was arguably produced the finest fast bowlers of all time. Obviously, there were the great West Indies foursome, but there was also Thompson, Lilly,
obviously the Somerset side, captained by Marcus Trescothick, Aral Sapire, Nick Compton at 3, James Hillruth 4, Craig Keyes-Vatter batting at 5, Peter Trigo at 6, Lewis Gregory interestingly at 7, Craig Mesty, who is without doubt one of the most up and coming and potentially outstanding cricketers of his age, coming into play at 8, Vernon Philander at 9. Now that really is a fascinating selection. George Dockrell at 10, a very fine Irish spin bowler, of course, did very well for Ireland in recent international tournaments. Steve Kirby at 11. Now Josh Butler is Dynast 12th man, we believe. that that's not actually going to be the case. So
it's a mistake.
Sorry, I'm looking at the wrong scorecard. I knew I'd get that wrong. I'll go through it again. Trescothick, Sapire, Compton, Hildreth, Keysvetter, Trigo, Butler, Meshti, Philander, Dockrell, and Kirby. So, correction, Lewis Gregory is not, as we understand it, in the starting lineup. The Middlesex side, again, a strong side. Robson, Denley from Kent, the two openers. Chris Rogers, of course, for many years at Derbyshire, batting at three. Mallon at four. Dexter, the captain, at five. No relation, to the best of my knowledge, to
Ted Dexter.
Simpson at six. Berg, seven. Rayner, eight. Murta, nine. Roland Jones, 10. Collymore, the West Indian fast bowler, at 11. And London is the 12th man. Now, clearly, it goes without saying the toss has not even been considered because we are greeted in all to all intents and purposes with a grey, sleety sky. The Quantocks were vaguely invisible, and now they're utterly invisible. And the scenario as we see it is grey. I think the rain may be stopping, and it's getting brighter from the southwest. I wouldn't say bright, but brighter. And I think in the event of no rain falling, or no further rain falling, it might be possible to start at 3 o'clock, possibly. Possibly earlier. I mean, we have had such little rain in the last 3 months or so that there wouldn't be a backlog of water, as it were, for the ground staff to have to clear. But having said that, of course, the ground is so hard that much of the water that has fallen would have remained on the surface. Mm-hmm. The covers are out in their full extent. The practice nets of sorts have been removed, not that they've been used as such. I think there's no doubt, Ben, they will be played today.
Well, yeah, I mean, it just is bizarre when you actually rewind time somewhat. Last Monday, we were basking in the sunshine. I remember sitting over at mid-wicket compiling my notes for the start of play for that one-day game, and it really was a beautiful sight that day. It was like a mid-July, midsummer day. It was absolutely glorious, and it is rather comical to think that where we are now, when we think how beautiful it was last week, and what an extraordinary game that was. A game that I thought Somerset were going to lose when I left the ground, and Somerset came on the Middlesex side. Yeah, I mean, there's been periods when of course, poor James Anderson has quite understandably been extremely frustrated. But, you know, this is the game, this wonderful game that we have. I mean, if every match was predictable, how boring that would be. You know, people who don't know anything about cricket really don't realise that probably out of all the sports, and whether you can call cricket a sport, it's more than that to its lovers, but it delights, it seems, in coming up with the unexpected. And sometimes it might sound a bit crazy to say this, but there's nothing worse than a one-sided victory, even if you're the team that wins. I'm one of those people that I love to see a contest. You know, if England do win, I like to see something that's hard fought and something competitive. I think that's what we all want to see. And that's where it can be so disappointing when, you know, you see a West Indies team turning up in freezing conditions in May, probably all their best players at the IPL or whatever, and you know, when the heart really isn't in it, when, you know, as I say, years gone by, probably the greatest team ever known. So I think, you know, I just think it's about, obviously, that the IPL has a bit of an impact on teams and their strengths, but I think we all just want to see something competitive. And if England win, then that's a bonus. That's how I feel about it.
It'd be lovely to see them do so. It's, of course, in the recent years, in the last year or two, no more, since the introduction of the DRS, that has, should we say, precipitated premature ends to test matches. I think a lot of people are concerned that the benefit of the doubt, which has always traditionally favoured batsmen, no longer does so now, and one still finds oneself cringing when the ball hits a leg bail by a quarter of a millimetre and it's given out. The worrying characteristic of the DR